I recently traveled in Australia and made a film on the dreaming and the song lines. I mentioned that the Australian people were the first wave to come out of Africa. They reached Australia 55,000 years ago. When the British first encountered the Aboriginal people, they found a material culture that was simple, a people who clearly had no interest in improving upon their lot. The British not only found this bizarre, they found it deeply offensive. And as recently as 1902, it was debated in the Parliament of Australia as to whether Australian people were even, Aboriginal people were even human beings. And as recently as the 1930s, you could shoot an Aboriginal person with impunity. As recently as the 1960s, a friend of mine, an Australian anthropologist, studied in school in South Australia a textbook called A Treasury of Fauna of Australia that included the Aboriginal people amongst the fauna of the country, along with kangaroos. But what was really going on is that the British had no appreciation for the subtleties of a philosophy that was one of the most primal instincts in the history of the human imagination. When the Aboriginal people reached Australia 55,000 years ago, they went walking. They spread a series of song lines across the planet, the known world. The song lines were the trajectories walked at the dawn of time when the rainbow serpent sang the universe into being. The dreaming is not a sense of dream, it's a state of eternal now. In not one of the 240 languages of Australia or the 670 dialects is there a word for time. There's not a word for past, present, or future. The entire ethos of the Aboriginal life was the antithesis of the cult of improvement that so captivated the Victorian mind. The whole purpose of life in Australia was to do nothing that would improve upon anything. On the contrary, the whole essence of the dreaming was to do nothing but the ritual gestures that were necessary within your clan territory, a territory that was itself linked by the song lines to other clan territories, other tribal communities. But the purpose of life was only to do the ritual gestures that were designed to maintain the world precisely as it was at the time of the first dawning. It was as if all of Western intellectual tradition went into pruning the shrubs in the Garden of Eden to keep it exactly as it was at the time when Adam and Eve had their fateful conversation. The people weren't in any ways victims of history. They were in fact people who had defeated the very notion of history. And the purpose of the dreaming is to maintain the world in a state of constant stasis. It's the most conservative ideology that we've ever developed. But the fascinating thing to contemplate is that if we had followed this intellectual track of humanity, yes, we would not have put a man on the moon, but we also would not be talking about our capacity to change through climate change, the biological life supports of the planet itself. The Australian people were not somehow primitive savages, as the British maintained, but were in fact subtle natural philosophers who developed a completely cosmic notion of how you could live on that planet. Fire for them was a profoundly regenerative thing, which we now know biologically to have been the case. The animals had a relationship with human beings that was simply astonishing, and of course the whole thing was driven on the theme of stasis, continuity, keeping the world exactly as it was at the time of the dawning. Now, another major threat to culture is, of course, ideology. This is a Buddhist nun at Angkor Wat who you can see has had her hands and feet cut off from her body for the crime of pursuing her religious faith during the era of Pol Pot. And if we go up into Tibet, you can see the consequences of the fateful conversation that Mao Zedong, the man who imported this Western ideology invented by a German in the reading room of the British Library, Marxist-Leninist thought, When Mao Zedong famously whispered into the ears of the Dalai Lama that all religion was poison, the Dalai Lama knew what was coming. And when the British invaded, Chinese invaded Lhasa in 1959, as a direct consequence of that, of course, 1 million Tibetans were killed, 6,000 religious structures and temples were reduced to dust and riprap. And what was it about the Tibetan Buddhist idea that so offended the materialist Chinese? A man like Mao Zedong, who had the dubious distinction of having been responsible for the death of more of his own people in his lifetime than Hitler and Stalin combined. What was it about the Buddhist path, the Four Noble Truths, all life is suffering? All the Buddha meant by that is that things happen. the source of suffering is ignorance. By that, the Buddha didn't mean stupidity. It meant the human tendency to cling to the illusion of our own centrality in the stream of existence. The third of the Noble Truths was the revelation that ignorance could be overcome. And the fourth and most important was the delineation of a contemplative practice that not only had the possibility of a transformation of the human heart, but had 2,500 years of empirical evidence suggesting that such a transformation was a certainty. So with Matthieu Ricard, we went on this odd pilgrimage of the heart to the flanks of Everest with this Amshi doctor, Sherab Barma, not seeking to climb the mountain, as so many do, but rather to find a woman who we had heard about, who 55 years before had gone into lifelong retreat as a Tsitsampa nun, and we wanted to experience what that might have meant. And in the course of this journey, of course, guided by Matthieu, we were practicing meditation as we moved up closer and closer. And as we finally got to this place, and because of Matthieu and Cherub's presence and the blessing of Trulsug Rinpoche, this is what met us. You would have thought that you would find a woman who is mad after 55 years of isolation. She instantly began to teach us darshan, and she instantly said to Matthieu, you monks have just got to get rid of all this baroque nonsense you do. It all comes down to the mantra. And she had spent 55 years reciting a single mantra, and she was the wisdom hero, the bodhisattva, the person who gives up life in the realm of samsara, stays in the realm of samsara to facilitate the liberation of all sentient beings. And the fascinating thing about this, of course, is that for the Buddhist, the proof of the efficacy of the science of the mind that is Tibetan Buddhism is precisely the serenity of those achieved by those who follow the Buddhist path. And that's what the Lama meant when he said to us that we don't believe in the West that you went to the moon, but you did. You may not believe that we achieve enlightenment in one lifetime, but we do.